scholar. I never thought I would even momentarily share a stage with Allison, so this is terrific for me. So I'm stealing a small bit of her glory. But Alice has been a contributor to social psychology, developmental psychology, and society for over 50 years. It's an amazing record. And later I'm going to, in my presentation, I'm going to read something prepared by the committee that selected her for the award. And it'll have the details that I'm going to lack. The Kurt Lewin Award is presented for outstanding contribution to the development and integration of psychological research and social action. And Alice Egli's career is really paradigmatic of exactly that standard. To give you an idea of the value of the award, and I want to tell you some of the predecessors who have also won this award. And I'm going to read it quickly, but it's fairly impressive. Gordon Allport, Margaret Mead, Gunnar Myrdal, Ted Newcomb, Morton Deutsch, Tom Pettigrew, Eleanor Maccabee, Marilyn Brewer, Claude Steele, Jackie Eccles, Kay Doe, and our most recent winners are Mahzarin Banaji and Tony Greenwald, 2 years ago, and last year Brad Bushman and Craig Anderson. It's a very, very distinguished group, and we are very pleased to add Alice to that list. And the awards committee wrote this, and forgive me for reading, but it's more accurate. Alice Egli received her PhD from the University of Michigan in 1965 after 2 years on the faculty of Michigan State. She moved to the University of Massachusetts and spent 13 years there, establishing a reputation as a scholar of attitude and gender studies. After moving to Purdue University in 1980, she added expertise in meta-analysis to her academic portfolio. In 1995, she moved to her present location at Northwestern University. Alice's dissertation study examined sex differences in responding to persuasive messages. In retrospect, the first sentence of the JPSB article that reported her dissertation was noteworthy for something everyone else was doing at the time, using the word his to refer to an individual subject who could have been either male or female. Quite soon thereafter, the roles of women became a central topic of her career's work. In the 1970s, when many women psychologists were seeking to document non-differences between men and women, Alice was fully embracing the accurate characterization of sex differences and was developing our now widely shared understanding of many of these differences as a result of culturally specified female roles. Alice started working collaboratively on studies of attitudes and persuasion with Shelley Chaikin in the mid-70s at the University of Massachusetts. In 1989, Alice and Shelley published their conception of systematic and heuristic processing and persuasion, a theoretical development that, along with the simultaneously developed two-process theory by Petty and Cassiopoulos, had a major influence on persuasion research for several decades. Shelley and Alice also collaborated on an encyclopedic 1993 text that comprehensively surveyed attitude research and was established as a powerfully useful resource in and outside of social psychology for researchers on attitudes, and you should still buy that book today. That's my editorializing. With all those other things, Alice became a leader in using meta-analysis to review large bodies of research, not only in her own research areas involving gender and attitudes, but also in helping others to adopt this then relatively unfamiliar method. Alice generously acted as a go-to consultant for those who wanted to incorporate meta-analysis into their own methodological armories. Alice has properly received major awards in recognition of her outstanding contributions to social psychological science. When I tell you this list, you're going to feel like we're a little late to the party, but we're glad to be among them. SPSB's Don Campbell Award, SESB's Distinguished Scientist Award, APA's Gold Medal Award for Life Achievement, APA's Distinguished Scientific Contribution Award, and election to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. SPSB's Kurt Lewin Award is awarded for outstanding contributions to the development and integration of psychological research and social action, and it recognizes researchers who embody Kurt Lewin's ideal of constructing the bridge from the academic ivory tower to the everyday world. Alice's work on gender has done just this. Her presidential address to SPSE in 2015 provided an especially interesting example in which she tackled the problem of misuses of scientific evidence in the advocacy of gender and racial diversity in corporate boards and work groups. Alice observed how advocates had unwisely favored anecdotal reports over meta-analytic findings. Her address, which by the way, was published in the Journal of Social Issues in 2016 and is a great read, and I highly encourage you to read it. Her address provided a courageous example of how scientific research can inform political advocacy. Please join me in welcoming Alice Eagley to receive.
Thank you, Chris, for that very wonderful introduction. It's really a great honor to receive this award from SPCI because it's the organization that really speaks to the core values of many psychologists. And so it's been a kind of a beacon throughout my career, SPCI. I've always valued my membership and my activities within SPCI. But, you know, it hasn't been simple in SPCI because it also led me to think a lot about the relationships between politics and science and political ideology and what we know as scientists. So I often found coming to SPCI was, you know, it made me think a lot about my values. And so I'm going to probe these issues in this talk by talking about the relationship between feminist ideology and science on sex and gender. Well, I first began to worry about these issues way back before most of you were born, I think. This was in the 1970s when I first taught a course on what we then called the psychology of women. And it was like a first time. There weren't such courses before. This is when I was at the University of Massachusetts. And so a colleague asked me, well, would I take a feminist perspective in teaching this course? And I just paused, and I didn't know how to answer it because it didn't seem like a very simple question, because feminism is a political ideology and a political movement. And I saw myself as teaching a course on science. What do we as psychologists know about sex and gender? What would the data be, etc.? And so it seemed to me that a political approach, if that's what it would be kind of a double-edged sword. It would motivate and maybe make the course more exciting if I talked about feminism a lot. But on the other hand, I thought it could be a bias in relation to the science, because I might only then tell about certain things that seem to fit the feminist agenda. So we were very sensitized to bias in the 1970s because of what had happened in the 1960s, that psychologists had discovered that we weren't very objective after all. There was the Rosenthal's work on experimental expectancy effects, which were quite shocking, and Orne's work on demand characteristics, and Crown and Marlowe's demonstrations of social desirability bias. So if we ever thought we were objective, it was certainly killed at that point, that we realized that objectivity, and you know, that was more of a goal, it certainly wasn't a given. And there was a great epistemological shift at that point in pretty much all of the sciences, from positivism to post-positivism. And in post-positivism, that we kind of unknowingly adopted objectivity as a goal. It's not a given. We have to work at it. So we had to understand how to get around experimental expectancy biases. And of course, we're still struggling, right? Because we have p-hacking now and the replication crisis. And so again, we're struggling how to get around these things that are obviously biasing in relation to our science. Well, most of the concern about bias, starting in the 1960s, it was embedded in the psychology of the experiment and our measures, and so is, you know, p-hacking and that kind of thing. It's embedded in the process of science. But we have a new concern that's been raised, and is quite prominently raised, and it is a concern about liberal bias. That psychology has a liberal bias, and that would be particularly an accusation of social psychology, because we're closest to issues of politics and social policy. And so this has been, you know, prominently pronounced that we have a political bias, and that we should think about that and maybe do something about it. Well, I've been thinking about it a lot in relation to sex and gender research. I think we should take political bias out of the shadows, and particularly here in SPSE, I think there's no better place, because people have strong political commitments in SPSE, and there's a question about what that does to our science that we got to take really seriously, I think. And SPSE has, it's very concerned about ideology and bias and social policy, but we also have a commitment to the honest broker notion of how we should deal with these issues. That is, when we do take part in advocacy and policy discussion, we use the science fairly. We don't use it selectively. We don't use just the science that happens to fit our ideology. Well, we know there's a lot more there. So I think we have to, therefore, if we want to be honest brokers, as we should, we need to raise these issues about political bias. So feminism within psychology has certainly been inspiring. And as a social movement, it deserves credit for motivating research on sex and gender. There's been a lot of it, as I'll show you later. There wasn't, you know, the first wave of feminism didn't bring us much, but the textbooks always cover the work of Woolley and Hollingworth as emerging from the first wave of feminist research. Because one of the reasons that women didn't have the vote was that we were thought to be somewhat intellectually inferior. We didn't understand things, right? And so they took that on very directly and did an early kind of intelligence testing work where they gave men and women cognitively demanding tasks. And guess what? The women did just as well as the men. So that was a kind of a start. But in feminism's second wave, of course, there were a great many researchers working on feminist issues and a much more complex research agenda. So in the early efforts, feminists attack much of what went before. They didn't attack Woolley and Hollingworth, but they attacked a lot of famous psychologists, because of the notions they had about gender tended to be rooted in rather intrinsic sex differences. Concepts like maternal instinct seemed to be rather popular. And so an example of the kind of thing was attacked. Bruno Bettelheim, who was then a very prominent psychologist, this was a statement that he made in a conference on women in science and engineering. Why don't we have many women in science and engineering? We must start with the realization that as much as we want women to be good scientists and engineers, they want first and foremost to be womanly companions of men and to be mothers. Really? Oh, okay. And so there was some wonderful writing, Stephanie Shields among others, that kind of eviscerated all this maternal instinct stuff that had been around. And expressing the spirit of a new research, I think this statement by Naomi Weisstein, who was one of the early participators in feminist psychology, she caught it very nicely. She wrote, we must understand the social conditions under which women live if one is going to attempt to explain the behavior of women. And to understand the social conditions under which women live, one must be cognizant of social expectations about women. So research then surged, and most of it pertained in one way or another to understanding and ameliorating female disadvantage. So researchers did find cause in the social context of women's lives. I think I want this one. I'll have to go back to that one. So this is the kind of research that was done. That researchers were interested in issues that had to do with what the environment was doing in terms of limiting women. And so we researched on things like double standards, where women have to meet a higher standard of competence than men do, double binds, where women can face backlash for agentic behavior, stereotype threat, whereby a fear of confirming others' negative expectations could make women's performance fall apart. And also, there was an acknowledgement of widely held attitudes, such as hostile and benevolent sexism that would work to disadvantage women. So research surged. Here's the surging of research. This is a somewhat complicated diagram here, but what we're seeing is research on the psychology of women and gender over time. And we're going from 1960 up to 2017. And the metric here is articles per 1,000 in PsycINFO. And we see this research starting out and going to a peak and then falling and rising and then falling. So the green line is a narrow definition in terms of PsycINFO index terms as articles having to do with human sex differences. That's widely used as an index term. And then for the second line there, the blue one, that included a variety of other index terms having to do with the psychology of gender, such as androgyny and femininity. And then the third one included even broader terms having to do with women and mothers and feminism. And you see what happened with the social movement. There was just a rise that was quite striking. And then a falling off of interest. I don't know why we get the falling and the second rise. I think it may have had to do with researchers becoming established, getting tenure or whatever, and finding they could continue this research. So there was a rise and then there's a fall. And that fall is a little disturbing because it's a fall that's been continuing. And it's, you know, a little bit more striking very recently. So there may be a couple of things that are happening. One is that that the field of psychology has expanded to more and more topics. And so this is relatively less numerous. But it also could be a falling of interest in the psychology of gender and women. And so we need to think about that. Is that really the case? But there's certainly a clear pattern. Okay, so research proceeded on a variety of topics that had to do mainly with seeing the problems of female disadvantage as rooted in the environment, as Naomi Weisstein told us we should. There was also really relatively little interest in the person. You could say, well, surely there was research on individual differences because both Bem and Spence had produced these measures that are so widely used of masculinity and femininity. But those were not so much interesting in terms of individual differences, but in terms of deconstructing the idea of sex differences, that it really wasn't sex, per se, that produced differences. It was the psychology of masculinity and femininity. When research did find the causes of disadvantage inside the person, it was not popular among feminists. It tended to be quite roundly rejected. The best example is Tina Horner's work on fear of success, which many of you may not have heard of. It was briefly popular, and there was discussion, and it was dropped very quickly. It elicited a barrage of criticism among feminist researchers. And this is an example of one of the kinds of rejections that appeared. This is from Paludi. "It would therefore appear to be desirable to abandon the label fear of success, since its continuing use serves only to reinforce the popular and widespread but scientifically unfounded idea that sex differences in occupational or academic participation are attributable to an intrapsychic difference between men and women, and thus serve to blame the victim." We were not allowed to blame victims, to blame women. So there was quite a lot of work that compared the sexes. And when that research started to be kind of popular, many feminists rejected it as not appropriate. They argued that such research posited stable qualities inside the person that would disfavor women, and it gave insufficient attention to the environment or to situational pressures. Well, the research went on, and what happened, which was alluded to, was that meta-analysis took over this research. We learned how to do meta-analyses, and I was an early adopter. And so the effect sizes replaced the simple dichotomy of similarity and difference. And comparing men and women became very popular, actually, in psychology. If you look at how many meta-analyses of sex differences there have been, I looked recently in PsycINFO. These are all classified under human sex differences. It's 538 meta-analyses. That is hundreds of thousands of studies. And so that is amazing in and of itself. But then this research became more palatable to feminists when the conclusion developed that what we had found is that sex differences are small, right? That we had, this is Hyde's gender similarity hypothesis, that actually it's been wonderful, this research on sex differences, because we found similarity, and therefore that would shatter stereotypes, which is the purpose of many feminist psychologists. So particularly unpopular was research that posited biological causes of female disadvantage. This research was fiercely rejected as reductionist and harmful to women. Gloria Steinem reportedly remarked, "It's really the remnant of an anti-American crazy thinking to do this kind of research." After all, we thought, you know, that the biological notions like maternal instinct had been vanquished back in the 70s with the various critiques that were offered. And then, some biological scientists kept doing this. And in particular, feminists had to encounter something quite important in the 1970s, which was the rise of sociobiology. Wilson's very successful and popular book, Sociobiology, The New Synthesis, was published in 1975. Sex differences were front and center in this work. And so that was a bit of a shock to me. I mean, I thought, oh my goodness, what is this? But it was a very important, and remains an important, scientific statement. And of course, it led to the development of evolutionary psychology within psychology, where again, the analysis of sex differences is very important. So feminists, many, reacted with alarm in various ways. And, there were like biologist Ruth Bleier and then various psychologists mounted criticisms that were a mix of scientific and usually political criticisms of work by sociobiologists and evolutionary psychologists. But But that was something to contend with. We thought sex differences were disappearing, didn't we? And wow, did they come back in scientific discourse in a major way. So we went on, though. And within mainstream feminist psychology, we produced a certain description. It was a kind of a consensus description, at least for a while, that the phenomena of female disadvantage are rooted in the external environment, in the patriarchal structure of families, task groups, organizations, and nations. So in this understanding, the individual traits of women and men, you know, they have very little to do with this, because after all, women and men are similar, right? They're practically identical, so how could their traits have anything to do with it? Except for reproduction, biology was thought to be irrelevant as well. Therefore, there was only one route to gender equality, that was dismantling the structures that oppress women. So you might note that this description is fully consistent with the political ideology of progressive liberalism, and with liberal feminist thinking in particular. So, given the contemporary critique of psychology is biased by its political liberalism, maybe we ought to think about this. Does this consensual psychology of gender really encompass all we need to understand scientifically? Might this be a bit one-sided, perhaps, even? Well, we should seek some guidance from a very important psychologist who is not involved in feminist scientists. I'll turn to him. That's Kurt Lewin. We could say, well, what would Kurt Lewin say? Well, his theory of behavior had a central theme, and that is that every psychological event depends on the state of the person and at the same time on the environment, although their relative importance is different in different cases. So he gave us this equation, B is a function of P and E. Wow. Well, when I was a graduate student at the University of Michigan in the 1960s, I took part in a seminar which was led by Doran Cartwright, the faculty member, that was devoted to Lewin's work. So Cartwright had studied with Lewin as a postdoctoral scholar, so he was a very good guide to Lewin's work. So when we got to the equation, I actually wasn't particularly impressed. P is a function of P. Yeah. Yes, of course, right. But it didn't seem to have enough detail to get us very far. But I bring it up here, that maybe it could serve as a warning that psychological research can sometimes tip excessively towards P or excessively toward E, so that it might nudge us to think about both of these together, right? So sometimes it's political ideology that might nudge us all the way over to the P or the E, or sometimes it's just merely disciplinary narrowness. So I maintain that feminism has narrowed its focus mainly to E, and that it's time to welcome P back, as Lewin might guide us to do, and to understand how P and E interact. Furthermore, in welcoming the person back, feminists should allow it to have a body as well as a mind. So let's talk about bringing the person back. Somebody has been very busy at this, as you all know. The most successful effort to bring the person back to the psychology of gender is clearly Sheryl Sandberg's influential Lean In initiative. She focused on women as individuals and urged them to take bold action, raising your hand, speaking out, asking for the difficult, challenging task at work. It seems that large numbers of women were really ready for this message. The book survived an amazing 213 weeks on the bestseller list. It has sold over 1 million copies. And many women found the message meaningful enough that they joined Lean In groups where they discussed how to implement Sandberg's message. Apparently over 37,000 Lean In circles have been formed in 162 nations. You can't but be impressed by this. Well, many feminists were dismayed at Sandberg's message and sharply critiqued her for emphasizing P over E. That is, for not confining her analysis to the structural barriers in organizations and other external factors, such as gender stereotypes and gender norms. Don't we know it's all due to that? She instead encouraged individual women to take action, despite the power of the environment. Accusations followed that Sandberg was blaming the women for our disadvantage. And Sandberg agreed that women are held back by discrimination and sexism and terrible public policy, and acknowledged the need for reform. Yet she further argued that the conversation can't be all about that, and indicated that she wished to emphasize what we can do as individuals. Perhaps Lewin would have applauded at this point. Okay, so this is an example of some of the resistance. These are headlines. Recline, don't lean in. Why I hate Sheryl Sandberg. Why do feminists hate Sheryl Sandberg so much? Which way is feminism leaning? A critique of Sandberg's feminist manifesto. Feminists really didn't like, most feminists anyway, Sheryl Sandberg's analysis. The person speaking up. Okay. So, how is political ideology relevant? Well, what accounts for the enormous popularity of Sandberg's message? I think political ideology is relevant. So, analyses of political culture in the United States suggest that there is an ideological shift that has coincided with the attempts of some feminists to bring the person back into the analysis. Sandberg's book and similar efforts can be considered as manifestations of a more general change to a neoliberal political philosophy, at least among some, and away from classic social liberalism. So neoliberalism assumes a socioeconomic system in which the so-called free market extends every place in public and personal life. The state no longer takes so much responsibility to provide public welfare and instead promotes markets and competition. Individuals' lives are framed by entrepreneurial beliefs about how to get ahead in a world of competition. For women, leaning in enhances their ability to negotiate a world of markets and competition. So I think that the rise of neoliberal beliefs in society, especially among the more privileged citizens of the United States, I would add, is something that resonates with the Sandberg message. So in this neoliberal context, even in mainstream newspapers, we see, such as my Chicago Tribune, we see ridicule of traditional liberal feminism as, I'm quoting a journalist, obsessed with a dreadfully tired script, constantly telling people they are victims isn't so empowering after all. So why does the liberal feminist script strike many people as tired and old and not empowering? And I think the main reason, hey, there is a lot of progress toward gender equality, which is not often being acknowledged. And I'll just note a few aspects of what I consider definite progress. Here are some of the trends. That women occupy the presidency of 30% of universities, and are 41% of provosts. Can you believe 41% of provosts? True, though. Women are 28% of the CEOs when all organizations are considered in the U.S., and 45% of the CEOs of nonprofit organizations. A new meta-analysis of studies on the emergence of leaders from leaderless groups shows a definite decline in the greater emergence of men than women over time. A new analysis published by the U.S. Merit Systems Protection Board of sexual harassment in the federal workforce, which is a very large workforce, shows a marked decrease in everyday sexual harassment between 1994 and 2016. These are sort of everyday harassment, like sexual teasing and suggestive looks. There seems to be, according to the survey, which was the same survey repeated over time, a marked change. In academic science, observational data from actual hiring at 89 U.S. research-intensive institutions for recent cohorts indicated that when women apply for positions in science in major research universities, they're more likely to be interviewed than the men are, and when interviewed, they are more likely to be hired. This finding, which is, you know, an observational finding, is consistent with experimental simulations of hiring showing a strong favoring of women over equally qualified men. This is the Williams and Cece research. Not if the women are less qualified, but when they're equally qualified, there's a 2-to-1 favoring of women over men. Furthermore, after securing tenure track positions, female and male professors in recent U.S. cohorts in psychology departments have progressed at similar rates from assistant to associate to full professor. Women are not dropping out or being deselected, despite the fact that women have a lower publication rate than men. Finally, in U.S. business management in recent years, high potential female job candidates have enjoyed a wage premium over men because of their diversity value. So I think there is quite a lot of progress, and we're not talking much about it, right? We should talk about this. Then there's the Me Too movement, which of course has revealed a shocking prevalence of sexual misconduct among powerful men across the institutions of US society. But there's something new about this. Those men are falling from their perches. This is new. There they are. They are not surviving in their powerful positions. So there are a lot of encouraging findings, a lot of encouraging events, which are no means meant to suggest that discrimination against women is gone, no. But there's real progress. And so some important battles have been won, and lots of them we're still fighting. Some are lost, like not having a female president. But my point is that patriarchy is faltering, and that's one reason why many women are thinking that they can produce further progress through individual effort. Maybe we have a chance now. And so to engage in some version of leaning in as an individual makes a whole lot of sense to women. And the fact it makes a whole lot of sense to women is shown by the success of the Sandberg Initiative. Okay, so let's go back to Lewin. He says we should take the person and the environment both into account. So how would he advise psychologists of gender to make scientific progress? He would say if you just do E or just do P, you know, you're not going to get the whole picture. So by turning to Lewin's timeless message that behavior is a function of the person, the environment, psychologists of gender might build a science that's not merely buffeted by political ideologies, one kind or another. So I suggest that researchers should simultaneously consider two sets of influences, social regulation and self-regulation. So social regulation refers to the influence of the social environment and self-regulation to the influence of one's own personal beliefs and standards. Even though the external environment coerces behavior, individuals usually do have some personal choice, at least outside of totalitarian societies. To emphasize only social regulation or only self-regulation in the psychology of gender is to tell only half of the story, as Lewin so wisely told us 80 years ago. So how might they work together? Well, we've certainly established the influence of the social environment in the psychology of gender. And so there's abundant evidence, right? So how does the individual fit in? Well, some psychologists don't give much power to the person by arguing that the person is the product of the environment, right? They sort of cancel it out like that. After all, socialization. Well, certainly we have to recognize the palm prints of the culture on socialization and on the psyches of individuals. But individuals are formed by many influences, not just gender. There's the intersectionalities, there's all kinds of influences on individuals. And so thus formed by many influences, people go forward and they make some choices from the available options. Now the options are much more attractive if you're wealthier and have more social status, but all individuals do this. They act with the guidance of self-regulatory processes by which they control their behavior to be in line with their personal identities in relation to the available opportunities. So an example of research that takes both the P and the E into account that has to do with gender and has made some important contributions is the work of Amanda Diekman and her colleagues on goal congruity as a motivating factor, which she's particularly looked at in relation to the participation of women in STEM occupations. So one emphasis of this theory is the person. And she argues that the motivations of women and men differ because women accord more importance to communal goals, that is, to helping others and to basically working with people to make the world a better place. So Diekman recognizes an important sex difference. It's not small in the data. That is, that women have more communal goals, life goals, about what we want to do with our lives compared to men. Men are more agentic, women are more communal. And so that difference between men and women then interacts with the social environment. And it's one of the reasons women aren't so attracted to STEM disciplines, because they don't see them as offering as much communal opportunity as do many of the more female-dominated occupations. So the roles offer affordances, the women and men come with their goals, and it's the interaction between the two that's important, not merely the power of the environment. So, what about biological influences? Well, Lewin isn't of any help, is he? Because he didn't consider that separately, and he didn't have to encounter evolutionary psychology and developed neuroscience, behavioral genetics, endocrinology, etc., by which we've learned an enormous amount as scientists. I suspect that if he did live in our era, his intellectual breadth would have guided him to consider biological influences. So what kinds of biological influences might we consider? Well, there is the idea accepted by many scientists that psychological sex differences are to some degree preformed prior to socialization. And that's generally associated with research on prenatal and early postnatal androgenization affecting brain structure. And this idea has been somewhat controversial, but it's accepted by, I think, the majority of scientists who work on the biological side of gender. And it's gained credence in part from the data that developmental psychologists have produced. That is, there are early sex differences in children's temperament that appears so early that socialization can't have much to do with it. And so they take the form of boys' greater surgency and girls' greater effort for control. And these sex differences in temperament are accompanied by quite large sex differences in the preferences of boys and girls in terms of toys and their activity preferences. But that isn't all there is to it if you look into the modern biological side of research on gender. That neuroscientists now find early androgenization is just one part of a much more complex picture, and have discovered different classes of sex biasing factors that derive from the inherent inequality in sex chromosomes between the XX and the XY. So biological scientists have now identified a number of pieces of the puzzle that make up what they call the human sexome, which is the aggregate of all sex biasing biological factors. Some of these emerge early, as in infancy, and others in puberty or other points in the life cycle. So I think it's time to look beyond the prominent feminist critiques of biological science by studying the research. Here's an example of feminist resistance. This is Jordan Young and Rumiati. Neuroscientific explanations of sex gender differences added a new allure to an old-fashioned sexism. The endorsement by neuroscientists of innate accounts of differences inevitably reinforced the status quo and non-interventional policies. I urge you to move beyond the critiques and look at the research. One good place to look is this particular issue of the Journal of Neuroscience Research. In 1974, it was a special issue on sex and gender. It contained 72 well-refereed articles, 72 on various aspects of biological sex differences, mainly by neuroscientists. And if you read the articles, you see these biological sciences are not dismissing the power of the social environment. These are not the maternal instinct folks of 50 years ago. These are really good scientists doing research with new informative technology and finding lots of interesting differences that they're trying to put together into a story. They're trying to understand brain-behavior relationships, and they often, in their articles, acknowledge the fact of interactions with nurture and the environment. They do, that's usually there. If not in the main part, it's in the discussion section. So I suggest that feminist researchers can engage this work and abandon the short-sighted argument that any credence given to biology defeats the drive for social change. That just isn't the case. So, moving forward, how would researchers best develop scientific understanding of sex and gender? I think the challenge for feminist psychologists is to overcome ideological constraints to discover how social, self, and biological causes together cause the phenomena of gender. Partial explanations are just not sufficient. And won't move us forward with the other science that is being conducted. If we just say you biologists are politically unacceptable, we're not there in terms of modern science and moving forward the inquiry adequately about the psychology of gender. So, what about political ideology? I think it's both the friend and the foe of scientific progress. So ideology inspires research. Yes, that's why I started studying gender. It was the feminist movement, and it inspired me because I thought we knew so little. There was so much we needed to find out. But I think if the ideology perseveres with a heavy hand on the science over many years, it ultimately holds back progress because we go around in that circle with those same variables. We don't look beyond at what the other scientists are doing. Even within our own discipline, we don't look at all the possibilities. But I think that ideology is the most difficult of biases to erase because we seldom acknowledge it, right? We think what we do is right and our research is fair and unbiased, and we do not see it. We particularly do not see it if we're in a community of people who share our ideological bias, which is precisely what we're being accused of in those modern articles of being a community of liberal, progressive people, so that we don't see beyond that in terms of our ideology. So I'm not suggesting we abandon our ideologies, but that we, as scientists, try to see beyond them and to look to see if there is an influence. Think about how a person who's a neoliberal or an extreme conservative, how would they think about this research problem? How would they design a study? Try to escape the ideology and to see other possibilities. So, you know, we are responsible for improving our science, and I think that that requires that we start to worry about ideology and its influence on our science. So I think that that's basically what I, you know, have to say in this talk, that I think we have been influenced a whole lot by political ideology in studying the psychology of women and gender, and that if we don't escape it within our discipline, it's going to happen anyway, like the Sheryl Sandberg phenomenon. It happened, right? But we're lots of people who are feminist psychologists are saying, no, that's wrong. It's not wrong. It's bringing the person back in. And so please, open-mindedness would be good. And as I'm not critiquing the research that's been done, because I think marvelous research has been done, but that it's been limited in its focus. And if the goal is not merely ideology, but it is to understand women and men, the psychology of sex and gender, we need to be open-minded and not be imprisoned by our ideologies. I think moving beyond the traditional mindset is within our power. We are that complicated. We can do that. Then, finally, in relation to social policy, you know, as SPICY members, we desire to further evidence-based social policy. But if we could only offer a science that's imprisoned in its ideology, we may not be offering all that we could, right? So when we present ourselves as social scientists, we do need to act as honest brokers. And decline to misrepresent the science, decline to cherry pick and use only the findings that seem to fit the current preference or what we want to convince people of. So I think only if we do act as honest brokers in the long term will we be building the credibility that we need to deserve a strong voice in discussions of policy. And that's what I have to say. Thank you for coming.